So, is GPU rendering just for preview, or can you use it as a full production renderer? With the new VRay 3.5, you most certainly can. Today we're going to take a look at all the new GPU features of VRay 3.5. That's coming up. Hello YouTube, I am KevinTheDane, and today we're finishing up on the new VRay 3.5 reviews. Today is going to be all about the new GPU features, so let's lay them out there. Most importantly, for me at least, is the low GPU thread priority. That means that I can actually use my computer while I'm rendering, because I only have one GPU in my machine. Then we have support for some of the new features, the adaptive lighting algorithm and the interactive lens effects. I talked a lot more about these in the last week's episode, so there will be a link somewhere here and in the description below. Then we have support for some of the older features, the render masks, cast irradiance map, directional lighting, the V-Ray clipper plane, and the aerial perspective that were introduced in V-Ray 3.5. Then we have some added shader support. We have support for the stochastic flakes that were introduced in V-Ray 3.4. We have support for the matte shadow catcher, and we have support for the V-Ray color to bump, and we have some forest shader support for people using i2's forest pack. With improved algorithms and on-demand mapping, GPU rendering has also become a lot less memory heavy. And finally, they have added support for more render elements. So, it looks like VRay RT is finally production ready, so let's have a look at some of the new features. But first, let me explain how to set up a scene for GPU rendering. First off, you'll need a fairly decent graphics card, preferably an nVidia card that will allow you to use the faster CUDA framework, but most AMD cards are supported as well through the OpenCL framework. Let's open up a scene. Any old scene you have will do just fine. I'm gonna open up this iPod shuffle scene. Now open up the render settings window by pressing F10. Now, before V-Ray 3.5, you might switch to Active Shade to be able to use the GPU render in real time and still make changes to the scene. But with the new Interactive Production Render, we don't need to do that. So just leave it at Production Rendering, then simply switch your render to V-Ray RT and go to the RT tab. Now, you might want to change a few settings before rendering. First of all, you want to choose a framework. We do not want the RT to run on the CPU. So choose CUDA if you have a supported NVIDIA card, otherwise you choose OpenCL. I'm gonna go with CUDA. For me, I also wanna switch on the low GPU thread priority, or else I won't be able to record while rendering. If you have multiple GPUs in your machine, you can go to the next rollout and untick one of them to leave some GPU power for other processes, such as Video Studio Max or Netflix. I'll just leave this one on since I only have the same one. Just like with the regular render, you can set a max time on your render. This might be useful for rendering a preview of an animation, or if you're on a tight deadline, or if you simply want the render to be as clean as possible in 8 hours when you get home from work. If you are not using the time-based approach, you will control the render quality with the noise threshold parameter. 0.005 is production quality, and if you plan to use the V-Ray denoiser, you can easily go a lot higher. Say, for example, 0.05. Then just add the V-Ray denoiser element and we're ready to go. Open up the framebuffer and hit interactive rendering and your scene should render. Now, I've experienced that sometimes it renders far slower than expected. Then just stop the render, hit the normal render button, stop it again and hit the interactive button, and that should do the trick. Now you can see here that the image looks a bit weird. That's because the denoiser was already applied and is now waiting to update again. You can manually update by clicking here, and we have a much nicer result. But let's just disable the render elements for now, so we don't have to worry about updating them. Now let's test a few of these new features. See, I have this rim light out here, but it's kind of all over the place, making my image look flat. So with the light directionality, I can tune it in to illuminate only the iPod. Then, of course, I need to turn down the intensity as well. And we have a much nicer looking image. Another cool feature is in the frame buffer itself. So to test it, we need to activate the depth of field on our camera. So go to the camera and enable DUF. Now go back to the frame buffer, and to change the focus, simply right click on a spot and choose set focus distance. Now you can just click anywhere and the camera will refocus. A couple of other new features are hiding in here as well. You can select an object directly in the frame buffer or even select its material and it opens up in the material editor. Another new feature is the ability to render with a matte shadow catcher, and Chaos Group have even added it to the V-Ray toolbar. So all we have to do is click this button, et voila, we have a shadow catcher. But This doesn't work with the interactive mode, so we need to stop this. And let's just activate the denoiser again and hit render. There we have it, an image with an alpha channel. Now just save this out as a PNG and you can composite it on top of some other graphics. Now, a quick note here, apparently the alpha channel here wasn't sampled very well, and this surely must be a mistake. I'll have to ask around to get an answer, but if you render the same scene on a CPU, your alpha channel will look a lot cleaner. Now, I have a couple of more scenes here with some stuff I want to show you. First of all, I want to show you the Stochastic Flakes material. This is an excellent new shader for creating snow, car paints and whatnot. It was introduced in VRay 3.4, but it is now also available for the GPU renderer. So let's open up the material editor and have a look. I have here a VRay blend material that consists of a base color and two flake materials, and then a polish on top. The flake materials are put together so that you choose how many flakes you want, and then you control the scale of the flakes, and this will depend on your mapping. So you can use a custom UV mapping, or as I do here, an automated triplanar map that is based on the object XYZ. Then you set your glossiness, and that controls at which angle to the light source that your flakes will be visible. And together with the blur value, controls the overall look of the flakes. Then I have another flake material with some slightly different settings. And on top of it all, I have a third flake material, but on this one, I disabled the flakes. And that means that there will be no flakes visible, just an added layer of glossiness on top of the other materials. The blend material is an additive material, which is one of the features that is now also supported by VRay RT. So let's try to render it out and see how it looks. Let me just check the settings here and everything is fine. So let's hit render and let's just stop it again and render interactively instead because I want to show you another cool feature. It is not a new feature, but it is a great feature of VRay RT, so I'll include it anyway. It is the ability to zoom in just like with the 2D pan zoom in the viewports. So you right click and click real zoom. And then you can just zoom in on a specific part of your image and you'll be able to get a nice upscale view of what it will look like once you render it in a higher resolution. That is very, very useful and one of my favorite features of the VRay RT. Now for the next cool feature, the aerial perspective, I'll need a scene with some depth. So let's jump over here. This is a scene I made last year. It's just a plane with an image and then I have subdivided it and resculpted the plane. So, you can see I have a ridge here and one here, and they are both moved closer to the camera over here in the camera's Z direction, so that when I switch to the camera, the image looks totally fine and is not distorted. This is a technique called projection mapping, and the purpose of this is to give a slight parallax in the image when I move the camera around. Now, let's try to render this. You can see that it's not a very pretty image, so let's just stop that and go to rendering, environment, that's also on your hotkey 8, and let's go down here to the effects tab and press add, aerial perspective, and the visibility range that'll be 3000, and the atmosphere height, that's let's just leave it at 6000, and we want to affect the environment, and we'll choose a bluish color, something like that. And now let's just close this down and re-render with the aerial perspective effect enabled. And now you'll see that we get a fog effect here, and the parts of the mountain that are furthest away, they are covered most by the fog. Or maybe I tinted this just a little bit too blue, but I think you get the idea that you can add some serious realism to your scenes with this aerial perspective effect. And now you can also render this effect with the GPU as well.
If you're curious about any of these features, old or new, there's a poll in the info bar, so let me know what kinds of tutorials you'd like to see from me next. What I'd like to see next from Chaos Group are tooltips in the VRay RT tab. I know you can just look it up in the documentation, but tooltips are a lot more convenient. What do you guys like to see next from Chaos Group? Let me know in the comments below. And as always, don't forget to like, subscribe, share, tweet, whatever floats your boat. And cut!
VRay 3.5, take one. With the new VRay 3.5... But the new video is GPU rendering just for preview. Hi, I'm Kip. Am I in focus?